Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome you to Providence Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're here this morning on this beautiful Sunday morning. First Sunday in March. Hard to believe we're outside. Some of us in shorts. This is great. Wanted to let you know that we have, I believe is it cider? Coffee. So if you like a cup of coffee during the service, we're very informal here. You can get up and get a cup of coffee. There's some information about the life and ministry of Providence, an offering plate if you'd like to give to the ministry here. We appreciate that as well. You should have picked up a bulletin as you came in, worship, and I wanted to just highlight a few things on the bulletin, a few announcements. This morning, after our 10:30 service, we are bidding farewell to our associate pastor, Reverend Dr. Sibeli Santos. And so we're going to gather in the fellowship hall around 11:30 to have a reception. So you're welcome to come back and join us for that as we thank her for her ministry here. And so just in case you're not able to come back, let us just take a moment to thank her this morning for her service. And then the other, another item happening this week is our Theology Matters Conference. You'll see a blurb in the bulletin about that. There are some blue sheets on the table as you leave. There's the schedule. Starts Tuesday night, goes all day Wednesday till mid-afternoon on Thursday. You are welcome to come to any part of the conference you would like, any of the talks, any of the workshops. Free of charge. You do not have to register. Just come on in at the time you would like. Gather in the sanctuary or the appropriate room. So take a look at the schedule. We're going to have about 150 clergy here from around the country, from all over. And they'll be staying at hotels down South Forest Beach, having meals here and the conference here. So we hope you can take advantage of that as well. Also wanted to mention in your bulletin, the Connect card, you can tear that off if you would like. Give us your name and address or email address. We would love to add you to our weekly emailer if you are not already on there. And then I wanted to mention in our backdrop, if you don't know what's going on, that's our chapel in the woods, and we are doing a little renovation on it. We're expanding the front, putting in some bathrooms, putting in a classroom on the left side. It's gonna be great when it's done. Hopefully, late spring, early summer, it'll be complete. It's kind of our go-to place for this service if the weather is bad. But we don't have to worry about that this morning, so we praise God. We have one other announcement. I'd like to invite Rachel forward about something happening next weekend.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I actually have two announcements. He should never give me a microphone. First of all, we'd like to invite you all. The final Wednesday of this month, we have a Wednesday night program called Providence on Wednesday. And the last Wednesday in March is our wrap-up oyster roast. So it's a great time if you haven't been to Providence on Wednesday or you'd like to invite someone to our church campus. We have a big oyster roast back there at the picnic pavilion, and it starts at 5:30 on Wednesday night, the final Wednesday of this month. But what I'm here for today is St. Patrick's Day. So our church has a float in next Sunday's St. Patrick's Day parade, and we need help assembling it. And so next Saturday morning at 9 o'clock at the picnic pavilion, we will have breakfast. We have it all ready, all built. We just need people to help us put all the decorations on. So it should just take us an hour or two. So we invite you to come at 9 o'clock next Saturday morning. It's really a fun event, something really fun to build. And then on Sunday, anyone who would like to walk in the parade with us, we have the kids on the float, and we need just adults for crowd control and to hand out. We're giving out Frisbees and candy with like our church name on it. So if you'd like to walk along in the parade, you can come here at noon in the fellowship hall, and we'll have lunch. And then we'll walk down to Caligny, or we can take the golf cart down. Or if you want to meet us at 2 p.m. in the parking lot down by Celebration Park, we will be there as well. So the oyster roast, the last Wednesday of this month. Next Saturday morning, we need people to assemble a float at 9. And on Sunday at noon or 2, please join us. It's a really fun event.
Thank you, Rachel. Let us all stand and let us begin worship with our opening song, Here I Am to Worship.
Thank you. Let us pray. Dear God, the beginning and the end, the initiator of our faith, we thank you for this beautiful day in your presence. We thank you for this church, Lord. We thank you for this community. Lord, we pray as we host Theology Matter this week that it may be a blessing to all. We thank you for the opportunity and the gift of connection and living together in unity. Thank you, Lord. Right now, we would like to stop and ask for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, forgive us when we do not approach you with our full selves. It reminds us that in you and through you, Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We pray also this morning for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. Give them comfort, Lord, and give them peace. We pray for those that might be going through health procedures this week and those who already have been. Give them healing, Lord. We are grateful for the gift of today. Lord, hear us now as we turn to the reliable words of the prayer of our days, the one that Jesus has taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Right now, I would like to invite Alan Fu. He's going to talk with us a little bit about the moment for ministry this morning.
Good morning. My name is Alan Fu, and I am actually the newest member of our chancel choir. You know, for those of you who may not know, our chancel choir sings at 10:30, during the 10:30 service. A little more about my journey later. But, you know, as noted in the bulletin, in March, Providence has designated March as the Chancel Choir Encounter Month. And so, you know, there are a lot of opportunity for you to check us out during the month of March. And we would certainly love to have you join us in March to experience the joy and the beauty of singing and praising the Lord with songs. So, you know, I'd like to go over a couple of different ways for you to join us. One, you can check us out during our weekly practice. We practice at 4 p.m. In the music room in the Mills building, and no obligation to join the choir if you come to practice with us. And, you know, again, 4 p.m., music room in the Mills building. So that's one way. And secondly, you could also join us. Actually, our director, Jusu, has picked out a lovely classical hymn, Man of Sorrows, for us to perform together on the chancel, if you're so inclined, on March 19th. So, you know, you can do either or do both. You know, we actually prefer you to come practice with us and then maybe join us for performance on March 19th. And then the third thing is that in March, as we approach Easter, early April, we're starting to practice Easter music. So if you join us for practice, we would ask you also to join us on Easter Sunday as we celebrate with songs the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ on Easter Sunday. So a little more about my own journey. As I said, you know, I joined about 6 weeks ago. Actually, so my wife, Laurie, and I, we came to the church to meet with Pastor Bill about joining the church. So Jusu saw us and approached me and said, you know, would you consider joining the choir? So, of course, you know, I don't have any singing experience. And, you know, I was a member of our former church for about 30 years, but never a part of their choir. So I said, no, Jusu, you don't want me in your choir. I don't read music. Now, Jusu was undeterred. So she said, very nicely, she says, that's okay, you don't have to read music. We'll work with you. Just think about it. So I went home and thought and prayed about it. The opportunity to learn a new skill in my retirement, and certainly the opportunity to sing and praise God more often than just on Sunday mornings, really was too good to pass up. So the rest is history. I joined the choir about a month ago, and so far I'm having a blast learning and singing among a group of very dedicated and talented choir singers. So what about you? Would you take the leap and join us for practice on Wednesdays, 4 p.m. again in the music room in Mills Building? And no obligation to join, and no requirement to read music, and certainly all you need is a willingness to try, and perhaps a desire to cause God joy. So if you have any questions on the fence, talk to Jusu. Thank you.
God gave us a natural spotlight. I was just a child when I felt my Savior leading. I was drawn to what I could not understand. And for the cause of Christ, I have spent my days believing that what He'd have me be is who I am. As I've come to see the weaker side of me, realize His grace is what I'll need. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy said, no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said, no, sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. For God so loved the world that He sent His Son to save us. From the cross He built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but deep within our hearts, there is still a war that rages and makes a sacrifice so hard to see. As midnight fell upon the crucifixion day, the light of hope seemed oh so far away. As evil tried to stop redemption's flow, mercy said, no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said, no, sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. And now when heaven looks at me, it's through the blood of Jesus, reminding me of one day long ago. Gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no. Sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. But thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no.
Thank you, Daniel. It's always great to have Daniel here with us to help us to worship God. What a What a voice, and we just appreciate your faithfulness. Also, I wanted to mention, Alan mentioned our chancel choir, but Jusu's also looking for folks to join our praise team as well, right? So you can see Jusu if you want to be part of this musical group at 8:30 on Sundays. So if you were here last week, you know that we are looking at the last 24 hours of Jesus' life before his crucifixion. So last week was scene one, it was the Lord's Supper. This week, scene two, the Garden of Gethsemane. So it goes, sometime after 11 p.m. on Thursday night of Holy Week, after leaving the upper room, Jesus led his disciples east and then north on the road that ran along the Kidron Valley. And on their right, as they would walk on the toward the Kidron Valley, there were tombs there, tombs of priests and prophets and ordinary people who were buried there, thousands of them. They were buried there facing Jerusalem. The Kidron Valley is also called the Valley of Jehoshaphat. The prophet Joel in chapter 3 identifies it as the site of the last judgment. So that's why so many people want to be buried at this particular area. Because at the last judgment's resurrection of the dead, they are first in line, right? And they're buried facing Jerusalem. So as they get up, they're walking into the temple gates. Well, just up the hill is what is called the Mount of Olives, a mountain range lined with, of course, olive trees. And at the base of the Mount of Olives, overlooking the Kidron Valley, sits one grove of olive trees, and it's called the Garden of Gethsemane. So we're going to read about that in Mark chapter 14, verses 26 through 42. This is just at the end of the Last Supper. In verse 26, it says, "When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. You will fall away. You will all fall away," Jesus told them, "for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee.' And Peter declared, 'Even if all fall away, I will not.' 'Truly I tell you,' Jesus answered, 'today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times.' But Peter insisted emphatically, 'Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you.' And all the others said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, 'Sit here while I pray.' He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. 'My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death,' he said to them. 'Stay here and keep watch.' Going a little further, Jesus fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. 'Abba, Father,' he said, 'everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, not what I will, but what you will.' And then he returned to his disciples and he found them sleeping. 'Simon,' he said to Peter, 'are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.' Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. And when he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, 'Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough! The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer.'" Let us pray. Dear gracious God, we give thanks this morning for your holy word to us. May these words illumine our hearts and our minds that we may go out and be your faithful disciples today and always. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want you to just take a moment and imagine yourself in that garden, the Garden of Gethsemane, standing before Jesus, and perhaps the Lord asks you a question. Do you believe that I love you? Do you believe that I desire you, that I wait for you day after day, that I long to hear the sound of your voice? If you're standing in that garden and you hear Jesus asking you that question, what would you say? I mean, wouldn't it be great if we all could respond, yes, Jesus, I believe in your love. I believe that you love me so much that I have tried to shape my life as a response to that love. I mean, I think one could say this scene in the Garden of Gethsemane exemplifies that question of Jesus to us. Do you believe that I love you? I mean, it's an important question, a challenge even, during this Lenten season. Are you aware of just how much Jesus loves you? And have you shaped your life as a response to it? I think the whole 24 hours before Jesus' crucifixion shows us just how much Jesus loves us. I mean, as I mentioned last Sunday, we looked at the first several hours of that fateful period. It started in the upper room that began at sundown on a Thursday evening. Jesus and his disciples gathered around a table to celebrate the Passover meal, a time in which they would once again recognize how God led them out of slavery, led the Jewish people out of slavery from the Egyptians. But now, in this scene two, it's late in the evening, probably approaching midnight. They sing a hymn together, and they conclude their meal together. Actually, we know the words they sang because this hymn, like the prayer Jesus spoke as he blessed the bread, is still part of the Passover meal today. It's called the Hallel, a word that means praise, and it's the root word of hallelujah. The Hallel is composed of selected verses from Psalm 113 through 118. And this hymn that they sang at the end of the Passover meal, the Last Supper, would encourage them as they prepared for their walk to the Garden of Gethsemane. And as Jesus and his disciples make this slow walk together along the Kidron Valley, Jesus all of a sudden turns to those disciples and he makes a prediction. He says, "You will become deserters." And then a little later he makes another prediction. Jesus says to one of them, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And just hours before, at their meal together, he made another prediction that one of them would betray him. And his predictions are about to come true. Judas was already in the process of selling him out by telling the authorities where Jesus was going to be. And now Jesus waits for his other closest friends to abandon and deny him in his time of trial. I mean, surely this realization had to produce sorrow and grief in his heart. But even amidst the sorrow and grief, the betrayal and abandonment, this Gethsemane garden scene, I think can help us believe just how much Jesus loves us, how much he desires us, how much he longs for us, for all of us to follow him. I mean, let's look at verse 28 again. Jesus says, "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Remarkably, at the same time at anticipating that his closest friends will desert him and deny him, Jesus foretells their restoration. Another version of the Bible puts it this way. It says, "After I am raised up, I will go ahead of you, leading the way to Galilee." think about it. Jesus is saying that although they will betray him, abandon him, deny him, he's prepared to take them back. Even despite the fact that they would forsake him. And as unusual as that may sound to our 21st century ears, it is clear that Jesus longs for their, what will be, broken relationship to be restored. He longs for that restoration. It is that same garden that Mark, all the gospel writers talk about the anguish Jesus was under in that garden. Not only from his friends, the denial, the betrayal, but also from what he looked ahead towards. Jesus will bear the sins of the world on the cross in order to reconcile us to God. The greatest act of sacrificial love probably imaginable. So do you believe how much Jesus loves you? I mean, even though we deny, abandon, betray Jesus, he will take us back. Jesus took our sins with him to the cross. He knows our deepest failings, and he still loves us, desires us, and longs for us. I mean, he knows your whole life story. Every skeleton in your closet, every sin, every shame, every dishonesty, every degraded love that has darkened your past. Jesus knows your shallow faith, your feeble prayer life, your inconsistent discipleship, and Jesus still says, I dare you to trust that I love you. There's another scene in this garden where Jesus goes to pray. And he comes back and he finds these men of God that he has just spent the last 3 years of his life with, he finds them sleeping. And he says to them, the spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. I mean, not so much a warning, but also a point of grace to his friends. I mean, Adam Hamilton writes it this way. He says, we can all imagine ourselves after midnight falling asleep when Jesus needs us to be awake and in prayer. I mean, yet even in such times when the flesh is weak, Jesus has great love for us. And then yet in another scene, which probably happens now sometime maybe between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m. in the morning, on Friday morning, Judas led the religious authorities to arrest Jesus. And Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss. And as the arrest unfolds, Peter draws a sword, cuts off a servant's ear. Luke tells us that Jesus healed the man's ear. I mean, think about that. On the eve of his own torture and crucifixion, Jesus paused to heal a man sent to arrest him. Do you believe that I loved you? Jesus asks. Then, this scene 2 of Jesus' last 24 hours concludes with him praying to God, not what I want, but what you want, God. I mean, verse 35, it says, going a little further, Jesus fell to the ground and prayed that if possible the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yet, not what I will, but what you will. I mean, as we seek to live our lives as a response to Jesus' love, I mean, maybe that needs to be our mantra as well. I mean, we just can't bask in the privilege of that love. Well, we need to do something with it. Not what I want, but what you want, Lord. I mean, that prayer just kind of captures the essence of complete obedience and trust, doesn't it? I think when we can pray that prayer, we answer the question, do you know how much I love you? And we begin to grasp the kind of love Jesus really has for us. I mean, if nothing else, the last 24 hours of Jesus' life should show us, should convince us, should convict us that Jesus longs not only for us to accept his great love for us, but for us to live our lives as a response to it, to actually do something with that love. I mean, I would think that needs to be something kind of radical, maybe something great. I mean, kind of like what Jesus did, loving people who would betray you, loving people who might deny you, loving people who might be not like you or those who are different from you. Let me just share a story about a coach, a football coach, a high school football coach who must have felt Jesus' great love in his life. And he must have wanted to shape his life as a response to it by loving other people the way Jesus loved them. So here's the story. There was an unusual high school football game played in Grapevine, Texas. Maybe some of you have heard of this. The game was between Grapevine Faith Academy and the Gainesville State School. Faith is a Christian school, and Gainesville State School is located within a maximum security correction facility. Gainesville State School has 14 players. They play every game on the road, for there is no football facilities at the prison. Their record was 0-8. They've only scored twice. Their 14 players are teenagers who have been convicted of crimes ranging from drugs to assault to robbery. Most had families who had disowned them. They wore outdated, used shoulder pads and helmets. Now, Faith Academy, their record was 7-2. They had 70 players, 11 coaches, and the latest equipment. Chris Hogan, the head football coach at Faith Academy, knew the Gainesville team would have no fans, and he knew that it would be no contest. So he thought, what if half of our fans and half of our cheerleaders, for one night only, cheered for the other team? So he sent out an email to the parents of Faith Academy, to do just that. He told them that he wanted the kids from Gainesville State School to know that they're just as valuable as other people on the planet. Now, some folks, as you can imagine, were confused and thought he was nuts. One player said, "Coach, why are you doing this?" And Coach Hogan said, "Imagine you don't have a home life, no one to love you, no one pulling for you. Imagine that everyone pretty much had given up on you. Now imagine what it would feel like and mean to you for hundreds of people to suddenly believe in you." Well, the idea took root, and on the night of the game, imagine the surprise of those 14 players when they took the field and there was a banner the cheerleaders had made for them to crash through. The visitor stands were full. The cheerleaders were leading cheers for them. The fans were calling them by their names. I mean, just imagine how they felt. Isaiah, the quarterback, also the middle linebacker, said after the game, I never in my life thought I would hear parents cheering to tackle and hit their kid. Most of the time when we come out, people are afraid of us. You can see it in their eyes. But these people are yelling for us. They knew our names. Now, Faith Academy did win the game. But after the game, the teams gathered at the 50-yard line to pray. And that's when Isaiah, the teenage convict quarterback, surprised everyone and asked if he could pray. And he prayed, "Lord, I don't know what just happened, so I don't know how or who to say thank you to, but I never knew there were so many people in the world who cared about us." And then on the way back to the bus, under armed guard, each one of the players was handed a burger, fries, a Coke, candy, and a Bible, and an encouraging letter from the players from Faith Academy. I mean, what an incredible story. What an incredible act of Christian witness that was Faith Academy knew. I mean, they had to have known how much Jesus loved them, and it shaped their life so that they could respond to others in a similar way. They shape their lives as a response to God's love to them. So my question to you this morning is, do you believe that Jesus loves you? I mean, it is so important to lay claim to this basic truth of our faith so we too can shape our life as a response to it. Let us pray. Dear gracious God, we give thanks this morning for just being outside in your beautiful creation. We give thanks for your words to us from the Gospel of Mark. We give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, and for his great love for each and every one of us. Lord God, may we leave this place. May we go out, and may we live our lives responding to that love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Our closing song is in your bulletin, and if you are able, please stand. Before we leave, I want to remind you We have these blue sheets on the table. If you're interested in our conference Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, you can take this and pick any of the talks you would like to come and be a part of. As we leave this morning, let us hold our arms up in praise and glory to God. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the power and blessing of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.